God morning.
God morning.
Much better. I say God morning because we understand and we know and we affirm that God is all there is. So if God is all there is, then this has to be a God morning, right? So, and Emma Curtis Hopkins was known to frequently say that that which is my good is my God. So when we understand and we can acknowledge that there's good and that's God, and there's God and that's good, then all we see is good. And when all that we see is good, what else is there to experience except the goodness that life is? Now, does that mean we're not going to continue to have challenges? No. But how many people in here study trigonometry or calculus? Oh, I'm impressed. Now, that means you must have some kind of love for math. Now, I've got those who raise their hands. Generally. Now, many times we look at when we're in elementary school and we see the teacher gives us the math teacher gives us 2 plus 2 or 7 divided by, and we're like, we don't like the problem. But those who love math don't see a problem. They see a challenge. And they accept the challenge and they work through the challenge. Because the fact that there is a challenge implies there is an answer. Anytime there's a question, there's a Chinese phrase that I learned when I studied martial arts way back when that said, the person that asks the question is the person that knows the answer. Or he who asks the question already knows the answer. Any question that we pose, there must be an answer, or why else pose the question? So ask better questions to change what's going on in our world. Now, I start that off with, for those who do not know, some of you know me because I've spoken in various places, I see some familiar faces, so some of you already know that I used to be a public school teacher. So at this moment, the public school teacher in me is possessing me, and you are my students. So, there are occasionally times when I will ask a question, and it's a natural question that I want you to answer, and now is one of those moments. Are you ready?
Yes.
So, number one, do you have a relatively good imagination?
Yes.
Okay, because I need you to work your imagination right now. For a moment, I want you to envision in my hand that there is an apple. And I ask you, where did this apple come from? What kind of tree did it come from?
Apple tree.
Well, that's very good. They both start. And in this hand, there is an orange. From what type of tree did it come?
An orange.
How do you know this? How do you know? Because we've learned there's a certain level of being known by the fruit. An apple comes from an apple tree. An orange from an orange tree. Lemons, blah, 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 et cetera, et cetera. I would be very interested in finding that tree that you walk out and you look at it and it's got a watermelon growing on it. Something strange. Wayne Dyer used to say that if you take an orange and you squeeze it, what comes out of it? Orange juice. No matter how hard you squeeze it, or what day of the week you squeeze it, apple juice is never going to come out of it, right? And he would then say, when you get squeezed, what comes out of you? If you were a tree, by what fruit would you be known? And I ask that because this month, you're talking about what?
Prosperity.
Prosperity. That amazing magic word that many of us run from because we don't feel it, we don't see it, we're not experiencing it. But yes, you are. See, the thing is, we often think of prosperity in terms of this small little paradigm of prosperity means money. Prosperity may even mean health. But prosperity encompasses so many other things. If I were to give you I'm going to pick on you for right now. Okay. What's your name?
Shirley.
If I were to say, I'm going to give you $1 billion if you complete a task for me.
Okay.
She said, okay. She said, okay. I want you to go to Ocean City and count how much sand is on the beach.
Might take a while.
But is that not a demonstration of abundance, the number of grains of sand on that's just one beach? If I were to say, I have a question for you. How many songs can you create? What's the number?
It's not a lot.
It's an infinite number. And yet, how many keys are on the piano? How many strings are on a guitar?
Six.
And yet, the number of musical pieces that can be created, infinite. There's no way of saying there are exactly 7.4.9 billion songs that can... It's infinite. How many letters in the alphabet?
29.
We can discuss those numbers after service in the lobby. Beautiful. Laughter yoga. But with those letters, whether they're 29, 26, 23, I don't care.
Depends on the language.
Depends on the language. How many poems can be written? How many sonnets? How many lyrics to songs? How many novels? How many screenplays? Infinite. But see, we don't think of that stuff as demonstration of prosperity and abundance. The number of trees on one tree out there in the parking lot. What did I say, the number of trees? I'm still focusing on the alphabet, I'm sorry. Rewind. The number of leaves on one tree out there in the parking lot. Infinite. And the thing is, let's go back to that apple tree. Assuming that the seed that it grew from was very strong in. And the soil is rich and nutrient heavy. And that it receives the right and perfect amount of moisture and sunlight, and all the conditions are ideal. How many apples will that apple tree produce? In the length of time that it lives, how many apples will it produce? Bearing in mind that from one apple, how many seeds are in that apple, and how many apples are coming from those seeds, and from those apples, those and then on and on and on. So we're surrounded by absolute demonstrations of what prosperity is and abundance is, like it's everywhere. But what we focus on tends to be within these brackets. So I encourage us, I invite us to say, there's six different areas in our life experience. Physically, am I experiencing physical prosperity, abundance, wealth, affluence in my body temple? And let's keep in mind, there's several lines in the Bible. They talk about being a good steward, being a good steward of what you have. There's a parable about the master giving talents to his servants, and the servant that buried the talent was the servant that got punished. Are we burying our talents? Are we hiding? Are we not being good stewards? So let's go back. 2009, I started teaching at Arundel High School, teaching sign language. And taught for 2 years, couldn't do it anymore. And I loved the kids, but the politics of the educational system wore me down. And I let it wear me down. I took on the stress. So I gained weight. Then it gets to the point where I'm now having heart troubles. So I go to a doctor and they hook me up and they say, anytime you feel heart pain, push the button. Because we'll monitor it. And I'm walking, oh, ding, 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 ding. And I go back at the end of the month and he says, every time you push the button, your heart is fine. I don't understand. So I do the little stress test, you know, running on the treadmill, and I'm hooked up to like Darth Vader masks and stuff and doing stuff. And he says, I don't understand. You gotta go. And by the way, right now I'm currently in this body at the age of 51. So he says, you have the heart of a 25-year-old.
In what's wrong?
Like, I don't understand. This hurts. He said, I don't get it. Maybe it's just in your mind. So I go about my business and you know, cholesterol is up and all everything she got, everything is just shutting down. So I go to my doctor and my doctor says, your cholesterol is so high, your blood pressure is so high, you gained so much weight that I'm afraid that if I let you walk out of this office right now, you won't come back. And she teared up. And this doctor does not like giving prescriptions. And she said, I'm tempted to write you one because I'm afraid. And it terrified me. Because one, she was ready to write a prescription, and two, she was crying for my health. So, what did Ray do? Now, at the average weight of 305, that's how much I weighed at that point, 305. I walk out of there and I say, something has to change. Now, the first thing that changed, you would think, was what I ate. Nope. My standing date with Krispy Kreme continued. And actually, I was cheating on Krispy Kreme because Starbucks Frappuccino was my Wednesday evening date. That didn't change for an entire month. But I immediately shifted 15 pounds. So in 1 month, nothing changed in terms of what I was consuming or the amount of exercise. Nothing changed. The only thing that changed was what I was thinking. I started forgiving myself. I forgave the educational system. I forgave my parents again, forgave my brothers again, forgave everybody who abused me in any way, shape, or form again. Forgave myself yet again and again and again and again. And in a month, 15 pounds shifted. Now, I don't say lost, because how many in here have ever lost their car keys? And lost your mind trying to find them, only to realize, oh, they're right there. We talk about losing things. I lost my father in 2001. Someone may lose a spouse. Someone loses car keys. We lose things. And there's a part of our human mind that wants to find that which, to be reconnected with that which was lost. So I don't lose weight, didn't lose weight, because I don't want that part of the human ego to say, you lost the weight, I'll help you find it. So I shifted it. I blessed it, I forgave it, and I let it go. And then the energy shifted. Then what I was eating changed. Then everything else changed. So body temple, are you being a good steward? This is not a question for you to answer. Think to yourself, I see beads of sweat. Are you a good steward of your body temple? Are you taking care of it, knowing that it is the treasure that it is? Because the thing is, if we're not taking care of this, then how are we going to take care of that $1 million check that's getting ready to come in the mail? How are we going to take care of, number two, relationships? Are we good stewards with our relationships? Do we have an abundance of friends? And I don't mean, yeah, I got 47 friends, and I'm not talking about, I'm talking about an abundance of friends, meaning those who are in your life are there on purpose, consciously, with intention. They are giving them of their time, their talents, their love, and affection in ways that build you up, not tear you down. Many of us know that we have had or have now friends who we are willing to say, why do I hang out with him? He never has money when we go bowling. He owes me $4.7 million for everything since the... Why do I hang... He's funny, that's it. Is that really being a good steward of relationships? You're keeping them around when they are some type of psychic, energetic vampire. They're draining to you. You know you cannot call on them when you need something, but they call on you, and you answer all the time. Why? In the ancient mythology of the vampire, nerd. The vampire cannot come in to bite the person unless the person invites them in. The vampire can stay outside, hello, I'm the count, blah, let me in, no, let me in, no, let me in please, no, but we let these people in. And even when there are people who are already in our lives, parents, I grew up in an abusive household. Friends and neighbors, there have been all kinds of abuse. And some of them I can get away from. Physically. But the moment I forgive and decide and choose to be a good steward of me and how I relate to another, it has to change. Am I a good steward of my relationships? Am I a good steward of my emotions? When you wake up first thing in the morning, how aware are you of the abundance of joy and love and sheer bliss that is available to you as soon as you wake up, soon as you open your eyes upon waking up? But usually we wake up, and what do? We wake up, roll out of bed, and start the day. Roll out of bed, kick the cat, stuff, make our coffee, and put it on top of the car and drive away. Because we're not present. We're not present. So are we a good steward of our emotions? Are we a good steward of our body, our mind, our spirit, our relationships? Are we a good steward of all of this? Keeping in mind, now, there's a river. And a lot of times, parents will, keep their child on the dock, near the beach or whatever, and they're like, don't go in the water, because I'm afraid you'll get swept out by the current. But what if the current is exactly where we need to be? Think about it. Current means two things. One, the infinite flow of, the flow of the river, the flow of the water. Because when a body of water is not flowing, it becomes stagnant. And then around a stagnant body of water, it festers disease and illness and parasites. Do we want to be stagnant? Or do we want to step into the infinite flow of always moving? We as humans like to be comfortable. That's why there's a whole slew of things that we will not engage in conversation. We don't want to get in conflicts. I don't want to talk about that. And we bury our heads in the sand rather than having challenging conversations. But we have to step into the infinite flow if we are truly going to reap the benefits. So current, infinite flow, current being present in the current moment. We are always either focused on what happened. You know what you did to me last year? Don't act like you don't know, because I remember. 5 years ago, my mom said. 10 years ago, my dad did. Something in the past, but last year, but remember when? Or, but what if? What if I go out to get the job and I don't get it? We are so focused on these two directions that we are not here. And there is only, truly, right here. Ultimately, infinitely, this moment is forever. This moment doesn't end. Can we be present? Can we be great stewards of this present moment? Meaning, be present in our body. Be present in our mind. Release the need to worry. Release the need to fear. Because once again, fear is there. Who fears? Do I have a reason to fear the boogeyman that I thought was in my closet when I was 4? No. That was then. This is now. Do I have reason to fear what might happen to me tomorrow while I'm driving to work? No. Because I didn't know. So why fear it? The number of things that you already do demonstrate that you already have all that you need. Demonstrate, manifest, and be whatever it is you desire to be doing that. How many in here fly? And I don't mean flap, 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 or a cape. I mean get on a plane and fly. Okay, almost everybody. Do you realize the amount of faith that it takes for you to get into a metal tube that leaves the confines of gravity long enough to get you from point A to point B, and you're not flying it? You're trusting someone in a cockpit that you can't see to fly this plane while you're sitting in the back, drinking orange juice and eating peanuts. And yet the person in the cockpit doesn't see anything to fly. Like, there aren't lines on clouds that they follow to stay in a lane. They're trusting information from people on the ground who also technically are not seeing the plane. They're trusting the instrumentation that is telling them what to go, where to go, what to do, how high, and how. Trust, we already have it. You get in your car, you drive, and you trust that the people beside you, behind you, in front of you are going to be safe and cautious drivers. And so you trust and you go about your business. You already have the faith of a mustard seed. You already have enough trust. Question is, are you applying it to this thing called prosperity? Are you applying it to this thing that says, when fear shows up, and it will, it's part of this human experience. But what if the boogeyman is actually your ally? What if the boogeyman shows up to say, ha, you've lost your job today, and now, ha, ha, ha. For us, the lefty, that's a very serious moment. But the boogeyman is not to be trifled with. Ah, okay. Simply to say, do you realize you still have this in this trunk? I'm showing you that this thing is still undealt with, unresolved baggage. The boogeyman shows us this. But what we do is we run from the boogeyman, we run from the baggage, and we ignore stuff and deny. We eat or shop. Do other things to numb ourselves rather than step into the pain, into the fear, and say, anybody here ever seen Wizard of Oz? There's a scene when the Wicked Witch and Glenda tells her, be gone, you have no power. Are we willing to stand up knowing the truth of who and what we are to the degree where we say to that thing, you have no power here. Be gone. Because right here, right now, we are more than enough in mind, body, and soul. And so it is.